Welcome to the service. Once again, it's a privilege to be able to lead worship with you. So let's still our hearts and minds as we prepare to worship our Creator. In James 1, we read, "So my friends, don't be fooled by your own desires. Every gift God freely gives us is good and perfect, streaming down from the Father of lights, who shines from the heavens with no hidden shadow or darkness, and is never subject to change. Amen." Our first hymn is called "The Steadfast Love of God."
The steadfast love of the mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. Steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy
Let us pray. Almighty Father, you are our everything. Our lives are guided by your hand, and our hearts are filled with your love. Let us bow our heads before you and recognize you as the giver of life, the unfailing provider, and the source of our strength. We worship and praise you and thank you for all that we have. We know your love is steadfast, unwavering and unfaltering. In spite of what we do, we know with absolute certainty that when we approach you with repentant hearts, your generous heart will forgive our disobedience and you will draw us close to you again. Thank you for your generosity and for every gift you have given us. We do not deserve your grace, but humbly accept it. Amen. Our reading comes from Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 to 8, entitled Spiritual Blessings in Christ. Let us give thanks to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for in our union with Christ, he has blessed us by giving us every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realm. Even before the world was made, God had already chosen us to be his through our union with Christ, so that we would be holy and without fault before him. Because of his love, God had already decided that through Jesus Christ, he would make us his children. This was his pleasure and purpose. Let us praise God for his glorious grace, for the free gift he gave us in his dear Son. For by the blood of Christ, we are set free. That is, our sins are forgiven. How great is the grace of God, which he gave to us in such large measure. Before I start my talk, can I just tell you that the subject matter bears no reflection in what I'd originally planned to talk about. When preparing a service, I go to God and ask him what he wants me to talk about. And very often he tells me. However, last week I had no divine intervention at all, but I had some ideas running about my head. So I sat down at my computer and started tapping away at the keys. Before I knew, I had over 700 words written down on a completely different topic. I just kept going, as obviously God's ideas are far better than mine. So here goes. This weekend, many people have been celebrating Halloween. It's become big business. If you've been in your local supermarket, you would have seen shelves full of costumes, masks, sweets, and treats. You've maybe already had some children at your door. Now, in the old days, and I'm going back many years, they would sing a song, say a poem, or tell a joke. But today's trend seems to be just stand there and wait to be given something, sweets, crisps, and preferably money. However, Halloween is an event that is celebrated throughout. But it's also something that is surrounded by so many myths and superstitions with no real substance that, to be honest, I really can't see the reasoning behind the celebration. Halloween's origins date back to the ancient Celtic festival of Samhain, which is spelt S-A-M-H-A-I-N, but I'm assured it's pronounced Samhain. The Celts who lived 2,000 years ago, mostly in the area that's now Ireland, United Kingdom and Northern France, celebrated their new year on November the 1st, a day which marked the end of summer and the harvest and the beginning of a cold and dark winter, something we all know about. It was a time of year that was often associated with death, which is hardly surprising, as let's be honest, in those days people didn't live in nice houses with double glazing and central heating, nor were there any hospitals, doctors or nurses to deal with their illnesses. Celts also believed that the night before their new year, the boundary between the worlds of the living and the dead became blurred. On the night of October the 31st, they celebrated Samhain, when it was believed that the ghosts of the dead returned to the earth. If you want to find any more about this, just have a look on the internet. There's so much information. It's quite fascinating to see how some of these festivals have started and evolved over the years. Anyway, all this talk of the Halloween made me think of some of the festivals and customs that we celebrate in our modern world. Guy Fawkes, Burns Night, Mother's Day, Father's Day. There's even a Grandparents' Day, which I keep telling my kids about, but I think they're just ignoring me about that one. There's Valentine's Day, April Fool's Day. The list is endless. So many reasons for a bit of a celebration, and very often, so many reasons for businesses to make a lot of money. Have you ever seen the prices of red roses around about the 14th of February, or flowers in general around about Mother's Day? The shops are full of what we are told, everything we need for a perfect Christmas. Because that's another ultimate example of consumerism. Christmas. Supermarket freezers are filling up with huge turkeys and boxes of party foods, while the shelves are displaying cards, decorations, gifts for every member of our family, our friends, our neighbours, and even our pets. And let's not forget the obligatory chocolates, biscuits, alcohol, cakes, and savoury delights. What would Christmas be without it? But that's a fundamental Christmas. Sorry, that's a fundamental question. What would Christmas be without it? For a lot of people, without all the above, it wouldn't be Christmas. What, no presents? No party nights? No overindulgence in the eating and drinking department? No running around the shops in December, frantically searching for the perfect present and spending a fortune on the credit card? Surely not. That's what Christmas is about. So some people think. So here's my next question. Has the modern world become so shallow and superficial that Christmas has been reduced to a festival or a custom, a time for enjoyment and celebration, but with no real concept of what or whom the whole celebration is about? I don't know the answer to that. But can we also just be a little guilty of thinking that way? Can we sometimes be caught up in the Christmas merry-go-round? Now, please don't think I'm a bah humbug type of person. I absolutely love Christmas and spending time with my family and friends. It's wonderful, especially after the difficult months we've all been living through. But it isn't a festival, a tradition, or an event. It is a celebration. A celebration of one of the greatest happenings in the history of the world. It's a celebration of the day that God sent his only son. He sent him to earth to save us and to ensure our eternal life with him. So how should we approach this special time of year? Well, we can go through the next 8 weeks in a superficial way, enjoying the froth and not looking for the substance, for the truth. We can be like the world with its light-hearted approach to Christmas. We can tag along with the crowd, be one of the boys. We can follow customs and traditions, regardless of their accuracy or integrity. Or we can remind others of the real meaning of Christmas and show by our words and actions the meaning of what it's about and what it means to be a follower of Christ. Will this be easy? Probably not. When asked what you're doing at Christmas, how will you respond? It's a lot easier to say, oh, I'm visiting my friends, or I'm visiting my family, or they're coming to see me. And it's a lot easier to say that than say, I'll be going to church and thanking God for all that I have and all that he's given me. Because the world doesn't expect that sort of answer, but it should be the one that we're ready to give as Christians, and not just at Christmas, every other day of the year. Are we afraid or ashamed to talk about our God? Because if we as Christians don't talk about him, don't let the world know about him, who will? So let's get serious about this whole thing. What preparations will you be making for Christmas? What will be happening on December the 25th in your mind? As the lead-up comes and the weeks fly by, will you be spending time planning what goes at the top of your to-do list? Or will God already be written there and everything else marked on your I hope to-do list? Will you be spending time in the shops or spending time with God? Will you have an open house or an open heart? Will you look forward to getting presents or simply enjoy the presence of our Heavenly Father? Now, please don't think that I consider Christmas should be dull with no fun or celebrations. I certainly don't. But a Christmas where God is squeezed into a tiny corner or just ignored is plainly and unmistakably wrong. It's lovely to receive gifts, but the most perfect gift in the history of the world was given 2,000 years ago in a tiny baby. And we can still receive that gift every day of our lives. It was given to each and every one of us by our Almighty God. Take that gift, hold it, cherish it. It's yours and will last until eternity. Amen. Let's join together and sing that hymn, Come On and Celebrate.
Nothing else can bring. We'll give to you our offering, celebration, praise. Come on and celebrate, celebrate, celebrate and sing, celebrate and sing to the King. Come on and celebrate, celebrate, celebrate and sing.
Let's come before our Father in prayer. Gracious and loving Father, we are so thankful for everything that we have. You are generous to us, though we don't deserve what you give us, and often fail to appreciate all that is in our lives. For that we are truly sorry. We have more than we deserve, while others are left without even the basics. The homeless, those living in poverty, your people living in war zones with no hope and no future, many living with fear under oppressive regimes, frightened for their lives and with nowhere to turn. So many in this world who need help, which the affluent nations seem unwilling to deliver. Lord, we know that you have provided more than enough for everyone, but greedy governments and tyrannical rulers will not share their wealth, food, or even their expertise with poorer nations, therefore condemning them to continued lives of untold misery. Our world has become cynical, distrustful, and even contemptuous of those who have nothing. Loving Father, we ask you to reach into the cold hearts of those in positions of authority and show them that any power they might hold should be used for the good of all men throughout every land in your world. And we pray that you show each one of us how we can make a difference, however small, to the lives of those around us. We bring our prayer before you today as we remember the words your Father, your Son, taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain in your hearts forever. Amen.
Back when I was a kid, I thought gifts from God only came from church. But the more that I live, the more I learn, it's not always the way it works. Sometimes you don't see it till you're looking back, when you didn't get what you thought you had to have. Cause he had a bigger plan than the one you had. Yours didn't work out, and aren't you glad? When you take a look around, it ain't hard to find. Everybody's got things that money can't buy. If the ones you love are sitting right beside you, then I'd say you got a lot. The best things in life are straight from his hands. Like raising kids on a piece of land. A little peace of mind when the day is done. Where you think that comes from? That's gifts from God. It makes you thankful for the hills that we climb, for the waves that we ride, for the lows and the highs, for the wrongs made right, for the songs we sing, for the dreams we dream. Makes you thankful for everything. When you take a look around, it ain't hard to find. Everybody's got things that money can't buy. If the ones you love are sitting right beside you, then I'd say you got a lot. The best things in life are straight from his hands. Like raising kids on a piece of land. A little peace of mind when the day is done. Where you